Hey guys, we were at the Canadian Auto Show this year, and we had a chance to interview some really, really cool people. In this episode, we got to talk to Norris McDonald.
Yeah, Norris McDonald. He is, a lot of our audiences from outside of Canada, so you might not know him, but he is one of the most recognized motorsport journalists in Canada. He's one of the most senior guys. He's right now, he works for the Toronto Star, the largest circulation newspaper in Canada, and he's been basically covering motorsports for over 40 years, since 1970.
Yeah, so he was nice enough to sit down with us at the auto show for quite a while. Great interview, some insight on the new year. Some stories on the old years,
and all around like motorsport in general. Great guy to talk to, and he's a real deal. Honestly, he's like, as far as he's
fun.
Canadian.
He's a real fun guy to talk to.
Yeah, he's like basically an enthusiast. Canadian motorsport journalism royalty.
Royalty. Yeah, I was gonna say mafia.
Motorsport kind of. Hall of Fame.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. He's a Hall of Famer. All right. Well. Yeah. Without further ado, here he is.
Thank you, sir.
Enjoy.
Just doing the singing. But no, I, you know, look, I'm a big fan of, you know, I'm a chauvinist. I like Canadians, yeah. Right? You know, people shit all over Justin Bieber. I think he's fabulous. Hey. I think he's great. I want him to be a success because I like Canadians.
It's Canadian,
success.
Right?
Yeah. Sure. People, you know, complain about Celine Dion. Are you kidding me?
No, come on. She sells out 7 days a week in Las Vegas.
Absolutely. Let's not be silly about this, right? You know.
Yeah. Just because it's not your style.
Well, you gotta have an open mind on things, on everything, right? I always admire an artist, seriously, and it doesn't matter whether that's Jose Iturbe, who's dead now, but he was a pianist, right? He was a concert pianist, so he's playing the Warsaw Concerto, or Willie Moscone shooting a little straight pool. I like to watch people who know what they're doing, right? Regardless of what it is, because they're the best at what they are. You know?
The peak of human endeavor. That's
absolutely. Absolutely. It's great. You know, I mean, there's more than Sidney Crosby. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Well, this could segue into Lance Stroll, the Canadian.
You know?
Maybe with some talent.
Should we start with that? Let's talk about Lance Stroll.
No, absolutely. And I'll tell you. I met Lance Stroll when he was 9 years old. And he was, and he was racing at Goodwood Kartways, which is out here around Uxbridge area. And he was a phenomenal little carter. And you know something? It's interesting. About 1988, 89, I went to Montreal. I wasn't covering the Grand Prix and I couldn't stay for the whole weekend. Because I had to go on to Nova Scotia. But I went and bought a ticket for the day and walked in and I stood down near where the hairpin is. And here they came and there was one guy who stood out. I don't know what it was, whether it was the color of the helmet or whether it was the way the car seemed to kind of be on a little bit of a magic carpet, but it was Senna. And he stood out above all the rest of them. There was something almost mystical about him being in that racing car. And you know something, when I saw a little Lance Stroll, 9 years old, with all those 35 or 40 other little 8 and 9 and 10 year old carters out there, there was something special about him. It was, your eye was automatically drawn to him. And ever since then, sure, his father is God. More money than you and I will ever be able to imagine.
So that's not all that was special about him.
That's right. But the thing is that it takes money to go car racing.
That's a reality.
And each and every one of those drivers that are at the top now, whether it's whoever is in there because they either had the money as part of their family or they had access to the money either from a sugar daddy or whatever. But, you know, if they're not there totally on their talent, they had to at one point meet someone who was going to open a door for them by writing a check.
Yeah.
Senna yeah. was a paid driver for Tolman.
Absolutely. Well, you know, the most famous, my friend Jerry Dobb, sorry, I'm having a blank here, Gerald Donaldson, loves to remind people that the most famous paid driver of all time was Niki Lauda.
Right.
Niki Lauda cashed his life insurance policy to be able to buy his way, and he turned out to be a, what, three-time world champion. Yeah. You know, so
and a legend.
And a successful entrepreneur.
That's right. And you always have to have that, though, mm-hmm. one way or another. You don't. I think Mario Andretti might have been one of the few who didn't have access to big money and kind of went up the ladder because of his success as he went. But boy, oh boy, he had to have been an exception to the rule.
Mm-hmm. We were just talking about the Farnelli that's downstairs mm-hmm. that he drove.
Yeah.
Not the best car, but like you said, it just opened the door for him
mm-hmm.
and his Absolutely. Career now.
Well, remember, Andretti was, again, I never sensed that aura about him that was around Senna and around that I noticed around Lance Stroll. I never noticed that with Mario. Mario was a meat and potatoes guy who immigrated. You know, his first stop in North America was Halifax, Nova Scotia.
Yeah, a lot of Italians came that way.
Yeah, and he could have come to Toronto, where he had family, or he could have gone to Pennsylvania, where he wound up because of, I believe it was his father's brother was there. Okay. And so he went there, and of course they'd been exposed to road racing in Europe, and they had the Nazareth Speedway in those days, and so they just got a bunch of junker cars and went over there. And one thing led to another, and he started out in midgets, and then he got into sprint cars. But remember, it's interesting that he was in that Parnelli in 1974-75, and that's the tie-in with Parnelli Jones and the IndyCar effort. Mm-hmm. But Mario won the pole for the United States Grand Prix in 1970 in a Ferrari.
Oh.
In a Ferrari. Oh. And that was because Enzo Ferrari heard about this guy, Andretti, in North America and asked about him. And all he heard was positive stuff. So it was the old man from Italy called over to various people and said, we're going to put that kid in that car at Watkins Glen. And he won the pole. His first wow. time out.
That's amazing.
In a Formula
That's
One
a
race.
That's a big risk back then because you couldn't look him up on Facebook.
Or no.
can't check all his racing records on Wikipedia.
That's the way it happened with Gilles Villeneuve.
Yeah.
Remember, Gilles Villeneuve, just like Bill Brack, some of these guys were just essentially weekend racers. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it was in a national racing series, Formula Atlantic in Canada. But what happened was, and it's a great story, in those days, they used to have this invitational Formula Atlantic race in Trois-Rivières as part of the Trois-Rivières Grand Prix weekend. Mm-hmm. And this particular year, they invited James Hunt, Carlos Reutemann, and one other who I've forgotten right now.
Back when but you could still do that with F1 drivers, invite
right.
them to other series.
Well, you know why? Because there wasn't that much money,
yeah. Yeah.
right? So they would pay for Hunt to come over and give him money, and so he would come. Anyway, it was Hunt that went back to Europe and said to Ron Dennis, because he went back to Europe and said to Ron Dennis, you should see this kid. And that was because Villeneuve beat him. So he goes back and he says to Ron, so Ron Dennis, you're right. You can't look up, you can't check the records.
Yeah.
You can't do anything.
Yeah.
And so, bingo, I'll tell you a good story in a sec, which isn't Formula One. But so as a result of that, Ron Dennis flew Villeneuve over to England, had a conversation with him, and gave him his first Grand Prix start, 1977 McLaren at the British Grand Prix, where Gilles, I believe, qualified seventh and finished 11th.
In an older car, too.
In yeah. But then McLaren was either going to sign Gilles or Patrick Tambay, and for whatever reason opted for Tambay. And guess who? Enzo Ferrari is keeping tabs on who's hot and says, come right over here to Marinello, and we will have a chat. And he signed him to be a Ferrari driver. And in 77, he made his first start out here at Motorsport in the Canadian Grand Prix. This is an aside, okay? Mm-hmm. But there's a famous IndyCar driver. He's retired now, named Johnny Rutherford. Won the Indianapolis 500 three times. When he was just starting out, he was from Texas. He wasn't doing anything in anything. And he took his helmet and he went up to the hotbed of sprint car racing in the United States, Pennsylvania in those days, and went to a speedway and walked in and tried to talk himself into a ride. And the owner said, yeah, well, you walk in, you say, hey, you need a driver, because that's the way it worked in those days, particularly with short track stuff. And a lot of times owners would just show up at a track, wouldn't have a driver. And so, you know, would be a guy who would be, hey, I can drive that car. So, you know, Rutherford was a good athletic looking guy, good looking guy, good talker. And a guy said, and so Rutherford, without blinking, he put in his autobiography. He said, oh, I won the championship 3 years in a row at Devil's Bowl Speedway in Fort Worth. And of course, the guy had heard of that and said, well, get in the car. He'd never been in a sprint car in his life. And the first couple of times he made, you know, but he had that gift of the gab, and, you know, and he eventually taught himself how to do it. But yeah, you could lie in those days.
Yeah, you just come in with confidence.
Yeah, that's right.
I like the cut of your jib and give him the keys, right?
And the thing is that that's where the game of Formula One and the top racing, I mean, you know, it was around that time that automobile racing, particularly formula car racing, started to go cockeyed. Because up until that point, there were people who were getting to where they were because of their talent. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, Hunt, he owned a Formula 3 car, but it was his car. And he was out there and he was crashing and he was bashing, he was going at other people. And they called him Hunt the Shunt. But it was Lord Alexander Hesketh, who's crazy enough to be spending money. He says, hey, I want to go Grand Prix racing. Who's a good guy to have? And his mechanic, Bubbles McSorley, what a name, eh? Could never figure it was that from the soap suds or from all the champagne he used to drink. Right?
Sounds like a circus club.
Where is Bubble? But Bubbles McSorley said, oh, you got to have Hunt. You know, you're looking for publicity. He'll get it for you. So all of a sudden, here's James Hunt getting in with Hesketh, and then he gets into McLaren, and he wins the world championship.
Unbelievable.
Now, he was a guy who burned the candle at both ends, and that's why he was dead when he was 43.
Live fast, die young.
Yeah, well, that's an example of him, right? But it was around that time, though, that Niki Lauda was coming along. Ricky Von Opel was another one. They were showing up. They had the suitcase full of money. Mm. And all of a sudden, car racing became one of the most dysfunctional big league sports in the world. Because, you know, can you imagine the Toronto Blue Jays calling a press conference and saying, we have just reached an agreement with Jose Bautista, and Jose is going to play baseball for us in right field for the next 3 years. The first year, Jose is going to pay us $20 million to play right field. In the second year of the contract, he will pay us $10 million to play. And in the third year, he's only going to pay us $5 million. Everybody would say, has the world gone crazy? And yet, that's the way it is in car racing. Yeah. And I have a very good friend, Brian Stewart. He's out of the game now, but he used to be the king of Indy Lights. He wasn't a driver. He was a driver when he was younger, but he was a guy who owned a team and entered. And he would get so furious with me because I'd say, well, why don't you hire a guy to go get the sponsorship and then find a really good driver? And he would look at me and say, are you out of your mind? That is not how it works. They come to you and they give you the money and then you go racing.
They find their own sponsors, right?
Yeah.
But I guess that what you're talking about is kind of the transition from
the guys
with the big balls,
but again,
the guys with
it
the big
still doesn't
bags
make
of money.
Any sense when
no,
you think
about it. It's not a condition doesn't. That's sustainable. And that's what I think worries a lot of people. A lot of F1 fans, especially with the way things were going before, how maybe the sport, it just didn't seem credible that you could keep that going for too much longer.
Right.
Which is, I guess, like, maybe we can talk about Liberty for a second and the Liberty deal. They're saying a lot of what I think is the right things as opposed when it comes to like what fans were expecting to hear. Mm-hmm. They're talking about redistribution of the money up and down right. the grid. They're talking about more partnership in with the teams and maybe reducing the cost that it takes to host a race.
Right.
Do you think that kind of measure is like is actually going to help to build like a long-term future for F1 as opposed to like the short-term thinking?
Well, so I think...
Just before you jump to Liberty, I just wanted to say that I saw this headline yesterday just on the same topic that Lewis Hamilton is now paid more than Dieter Zetsche at Mercedes, the CEO of Mercedes-Benz Worldwide.
Right, the driver.
He's kind of the exception, Lewis Hamilton. But.
Yeah, no, well, absolutely.
Sorry to interrupt.
No.
I thought that was incredible.
Please, and I think you're right. Well, you know, when you start thinking that the top guys are making $29 and $30 million a race, you know, I mean, I'm never going to see $29 or $30 million in my entire life. if all it takes is 2 hours in a Formula One car, I can squeeze my way into it. You know? But they're not going to pay me that. Listen, you know, Liberty Media. I really, really hope that the promise that they're showing turns out to be the right thing. The difficulty is, and this is really the key thing, all of these teams, even though they complained and they bitched and they moaned and they groaned, have been used to working for 40 to 50 years now with one little guy at the top who, and what he said went. But you know what? Why did they not kick him out? Why over those years did they not say, we got to get rid of this guy and the only way to do it is we're going to set up an alternative series? Mm-hmm. They could do that. They never did. You know why? In the end, he looked after everybody. Mm-hmm. He looked after everybody. And he made everybody in Formula One rich beyond their wildest imaginations. And that includes Ferrari. You know, mm-hmm. Ferrari has always had that mystique about it ever since Enzo was racing himself. Mm-hmm. What a name, Enzo Ferrari. Yeah. you equate Ferrari with Italy, with a country. It's amazing.
The man himself was mysterious.
Absolutely, absolutely.
His routine and everything.
Well, there's a lot of good stories about him, you know, and I don't think the definitive story has ever been told. I think he was a brilliant businessman. I think that he was a character. I think that he was like so many well-to-do European business people. I think he had a very happy home life with his wife. I think he had a very happy sideline with his girlfriend.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think that he worked terribly hard every morning. He was in his office at 6 a.m. He went to lunch at noon. I think he was hammered by the time he went back to lunch. And I think that's why, you know, even though it's famous in Spain, that's why they had an afternoon siesta at the Ferrari plant, because the old man was sleeping it off.
Yeah.
You know, there's so many things going, but he certainly knew his drivers and he had the passion for the sport. But the point is that even with Enzo and all his power, he went with Bernie Ecclestone because he knew that at the end of the day, Bernie was going to make the deals that was going to make everybody happy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know, at the end of the day, read Bernie Ecclestone's, there's several really good biographies of him out there.
And No Angels?
Well, that's the best one. Yeah. And that's where you find out so many of the things that have been happening recently. His relationship with that German banker who's still in jail.
They were
partners, you know? You wonder how Bernie managed to worm out of some of that stuff, right?
I think I could guess.
Yeah, well,
$100 million.
But the thing is that he delivered. Yeah. And I am convinced, for example, that, and this is what Liberty's going to find out, I'm convinced that Bernie, I won't say he owned teams in Formula One, but if he was not subsidizing teams under the table, they wouldn't be there. You know, it's. In fact, I can. Well, no, I better not say it on camera. Well, after we turn this off, I'll tell you, because I've got a theory about something,
okay.
And it involves a pretty big team. But you know what I mean? So it's a tangled web. Yeah. It's not a matter of me owning a company and you come and you investigate and then you buy the company from me and I say, see around, and you have a business that you understand and that you know that you can continue going forward with. Mm-hmm. I think that Formula One is just a tangled web. Mm-hmm. I think, for example, and I can talk about this, I think one of the reasons that the Canadian Grand Prix has always been on the calendar, and in fact, several people made this mention yesterday when we had this 50-year celebration yesterday, is that, and I think it was Francois Demontier, who's the current promoter, you know, this is the longest, one of the longest, if not the longest, running Grand Prix races anywhere.
And considered part of Europe.
Yeah.
Considered
and the part thing of the European is, and the thing is that the reason is, I think I think Bernie Ecclestone owned the Canadian Grand Prix. Mm-hmm. It was his race. And that Normand Legault was his general manager. And Francois Demontier is his general manager. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody says, oh, it's a, you know, the Grand Prix du Canada is, a, well, who does own the Grand Prix du Canada? I think the Grand Prix du Canada is a personal property of Bernie Ecclestone. And I'm not unconvinced that he might not own other races outright, you know, when he makes a deal to go to Russia.
Right.
Where did that come from, right? And so it's Bernie.
It's all in those handshakes that he likes so
That's
much.
That's right. And so good luck to Liberty Media, yeah. But you would hope that they really, really did take a hard look at just exactly, because, you know, they can go to Australia and they can open the season. But by the time they get to Montreal, half those teams don't have any money. You know, I mean, my friend Gerald Donaldson, I mentioned him earlier, he is kind of the accepted Formula One expert in Canada.
Oh, absolutely. He was Gilles' biographer, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And James Hunt, 24 books on Formula One. Yeah. You know, no, absolutely. And I will always go to Montreal, and Jerry and I sit together every year, and he'll say, well, Sauber's broke, right? Well, if Sauber's broke by Canada, how are they getting through to the end of the year?
Yeah, how
are they
happen?
Doing? Well, I can tell you why. Bernie's got them going. You know, absolutely. Propping them, maybe even pan it. Mm-hmm. And you know, nothing happens, particularly with a guy like Bernie Ecclestone, without somebody signing a sheet of paper. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of IOUs floating around.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And, you know, now Bernie's going to say, hey, not my problem. So now what's going to happen when Sauber goes, and I don't mean Sauber, could be anybody.
Yeah.
We'll call it McDonald Racing, right? What happens if McDonald Racing goes to Liberty and says, well, we're done, unless you can float us a pretty serious loan. Mm-hmm. And Liberty will say, sorry. And they'll say, well, Bernie would take care of us. And you go through to the end of the line, right? Half the field.
Yeah.
So could be interesting. Now, I know that they're talking about trying to put a cap on things as far as spending. Well, remember, Max Mosley tried to do that a number of years ago, and the teams with the money, Ferrari, McLaren, the rest of it said, we're not doing that.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the smaller teams get killed again.
Yeah.
But good luck to them. Mm-hmm. I think the fact that they're going to perhaps pay a little bit more attention to North America, I think will be very, very good news for the engine manufacturers, Mercedes-Benz and Honda, because they sell a ton of cars over here. Mercedes was in IndyCar back in the 90s, I think it was.
Were they?
Well, just engines. Just engines. But otherwise, you know, they don't get that exposure that they're looking for over here with, say, a world championship caliber event, right?
Absolutely.
But
as big as a Grand Prix.
Yeah. And, you know, they talk about, you know, they're going to invent some other races. You know, IndyCar's got a contract in Long Beach going through 2018. It's got two more years to go. I know they talk about bringing down the cost. It still costs a ton of money to bring a Formula One race in there. And are they going to be able to recoup? Because these guys are not, this is not a promotion to sell something else. Like the Molson Indy for years was a loss leader because Molson just wanted to sell beer.
Yeah.
That's what it was. And so, you know, all the money in the world was made available to make that race a success.
It must be a loss leader still now selling Hondas, right?
Well, you'll notice, though, that the degree of promotion is not what it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The degree of excitement generated by the event is not what it was, because the promotion and public relations money isn't there like it was.
Even since recently, we went 6 or 7 years ago on the lakeshore, remember? And then we went this year, big difference in the whole, just the atmosphere.
Right.
This year was more open, I guess maybe because they have to be, but like the Friday, just you could walk around the whole circuit, you can get right in the pits and everything. But
right.
Yeah, 5 or 6 years ago when we went, it was full all down the lakeshore, thousands of people.
Yeah.
No, is that just like another symptom of the times, like motorsport in general is getting less and less popular in Canada? Can we reverse that?
You know something, that's really an interesting question. First of all, everything is a pendulum, mm-hmm. right? Doesn't matter whether it's baseball or boxing or, you know, ultimate fighting, a particular movie actress or a singer, mm-hmm. you know, you're hot for a while and then you kind of cool off and you're over here and then you get hot again. And you know, Formula One is, it's I can remember the early 1980s, for example, where they had so many teams, they had to have pre-qualifying to qualify to get into qualifying, you know? So, you know, there were 6 teams and 5 would be going home, packing up and leaving.
Yeah.
So they had cars and teams coming out of their ears. Mm-hmm. Now they're down to, I think, 20 drivers, 10 cars, yeah. or 20 cars rather, 10 teams. Yeah. And that could, again, as the season goes on, because of the new ownership, that could drop off. Mm-hmm. So you don't really know. What generates excitement? What generates information? Media. There are a ton of fan websites out there. I have friends who have their IndyCar websites, who have their Formula One websites, who have websites that are all-encompassing. The only one that I know that's been established in recent years and seems to be hanging on is Racer. Racer magazine, racer.com. And the problem with fan sites is that they're rah-rah. Mm-hmm. And so if people start to go and look for what's important in sport, they have to go to a newspaper or a television station or a website like Racer that has a range of reporting, but also there are other sports involved. In other words, there's some baseball, there's some hockey, there's some football, there's some basketball, there's some motor racing, because it's all part and parcel of what I call the mix. And right now, in Toronto, which is the media capital of Canada, the Globe and Mail does not have a dedicated reporter.
Right, Papone left. Yeah.
Well, he didn't leave. They just didn't renew his contract.
They just stopped doing it. Right?
Yeah, they just decided that it was a sport that they could do without. I think it's a big mistake.
They made a mistake, especially this
Absolutely.
Year. Absolutely.
Come on. I think they make a big mistake.
Year, the Suscicentennial.
Well, he didn't show up here yesterday, you know, for example.
Yeah, that's crazy. Just a whole new formula. Everything. Well, there's a Canadian in there now. What
are
they doing?
Well, absolutely. Well, I think you know something. And I don't want to get too far off the track. I think that everybody will get, I'm not necessarily saying excited, but I think there will be more attention paid to Lance the closer the first race gets.
Oh, yeah.
Right now, we're still in the middle of a winter. if he'd come yesterday, and we had him at one time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I was keeping my fingers crossed.
No, we had him at one time. We were told that he would come, and then something happened. And Williams decided that it was too close to the preseason testing.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted him there. They didn't want him distracted And, you know, I mean, there's so much money involved that you can't blame them.
You can't, right? Yeah, for sure.
And, you know, seriously, go to a spring training. The first couple of weeks are pretty informal, and the writers are out there with the baseball players. But then as you get closer to the start of the season, it's a little bit tighter and tighter because they're trying to form a team, and they don't need distractions. Mm-hmm. And so it's the same thing in car racing. But in any event, the Globe and Mail is now does not have somebody on the beat. The Sun Media, Dean McNulty retired. Mm-hmm. They have not replaced him. Mm-hmm. They had a gentleman come and cover the Honda Indy last year, but they were another, right? There was not a Sun reporter here yesterday. Yes. There was not anybody from the National Post, which is owned by the same company. Mm-hmm. There's a very, very good motorsport writer for the Montreal Gazette who does it as a freelance, who works for the Gazette, which is the National Post and the Sun Media. Mm-hmm. But he is employed as a copy editor at the Gazette, and he does the racing stuff on the side on a freelance basis. So consequently, you have me, and I'm it in Toronto. And it's I got to be honest with you, it's a deplorable state of affairs. And the reason I call it a deplorable state of affairs is, listen, motor racing is a niche sport. It's not a major league sport in this part of the world.
Yeah.
Not a major league sport like the Blue Jays are.
Hopefully.
Not a major league sport like the Toronto Maple Leafs are.
On the way.
Not as major league as the Raptors are. Toronto FC is coming on the last couple of years because they're a team. It's a worldwide sport like motorsport is, but it's soccer. It encompasses major cities all over North America. These guys got in the final last year.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, people are excited about soccer. Mm-hmm. I think for motor racing to start to climb up, I think, you know, put a lot of pressure on them. And in fact, I wrote a card the other day to Hinchcliffe saying it's the sesquicentennial. Nothing less than an Indy 500 victory and an IndyCar championship will do, right?
Yes.
Those are your marching orders, right? Yeah. Lance has got to go out there and set the world on fire.
Yeah.
You know, it's not just a matter of being there. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, here we had Alan Berg here yesterday.
Yeah.
There was a guy who was in Formula One. Can you imagine? Nobody in this country knows him. Nobody, right? Villeneuve's because of the name. You know, it's racing royalty and all that sort of stuff.
Right.
George Eaton back in the 70s, maybe because of Eaton's department store. But you know something, you walk out on the street, I always say this, go in the street and ask the first 10 people you meet, who's Lance Stroll? Maybe one person, maybe one. You're right. It's going to be good. Yeah, maybe one person. And that is the acid test as far as whether or not somebody is. I think James Hinchcliffe is maybe a couple. Jacques Villeneuve, probably more than half, along the lines of, does he race cars or something?
Yeah.
You know, there's not going to be anybody. And yet, if you said who's Wayne Gretzky to 10 people, that's what I'm getting at.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And so you know that you're not. However, having said that, there are three or four times a year that the media fall down and do not do a proper job of covering the Grand Prix of Canada, the Indianapolis 500, the Daytona 500, which is next weekend.
Yeah, it's coming up.
Right?
Yeah.
And the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Yeah. Probably those are the three or four big races.
Yeah.
And they should be covered like every other, because there is phenomenal interest in Canada and around the world. Maybe not all the time. You know, you go out to Motorsport. I don't know if you guys go out there or not.
I've driven past it a few times. I want to go there.
Oh, you got to come out. You've got to, you know, please, I invite you. Wonderful facility. They have the stock cars go out there and race on the road course.
Yeah.
They have the best sports car series in North America, actually. It's the only one, but still. The
Canadian Tire Series?
You know, well, the Canadian Tire, that's been replaced by Pinty's, okay? Oh. The Canadian Tire doesn't sponsor the stock cars anymore, but the Pinty's Foods does. Mm-hmm. But you get the NASCAR trucks.
Right.
They're out there on Labor Day weekend every year, and they put on a hell of a show. Okay. I mean, it's just great stuff and wonderful racing. But my point is that unless it's major league stuff, you could go out there on the middle of July and the sports cars are there, and you're going to have 60,000 people there. That's 60,000. That's more than fit in the Sky Dome.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's 60,000 people. The next weekend, you might have a regional club race with some terrific racing. I mean, really terrific stuff. Formula Fords and Formula 1200s and sedans. And there's nobody there, right? Because it's, you know, well, I mean, it really is. It's club racing. It's not meant to. But what I'm getting at is the interest is. What?
There was like no warning. It's like, again, like, hey, it's
okay. The mic is still going.
Yeah, we can still keep talking. Well, actually, now that we're talking about Canadian racing,
right.
Have you ever made it to the Targa, Newfoundland?
No.
I've only read like, and it just sounds fantastic. There's not a lot of races left really in the world where like people can just come and really give her through the streets.
I just learned actually in the last 2-3 days, there's another one in out west called the Royal Rally that's right. been running 2 or 3 years. But it's well. you show up with whatever you're running, and you get a map, and it's right. That's it. Nobody knows
well,
the race
you
before
know,
you get there.
This is good yeah. stuff for those of us who are passionate about motorsport. The Targa Newfoundland has been going for a lot of years.
Yeah, I'd love for us
it
to compete.
Let's get
a couple
what
hundred
mean?
Bucks and a beater and
well,
go up
there. Well, there you go. See, you can get a couple of hundred bucks and guys entering.
You get a beater, yeah. Right?
It's been going on long enough that it should be attracting.
Right. Yeah.
It should be attracting serious rallies.
Yeah.
Now
the Trailer Park Boys did it. You know,
well, that's what I mean. So, you know. Unfortunately, I personally, and I admit a bias, I have my standards. and there's a whole bunch of races that good stuff, go out there and have fun. Peterborough Speedway on a Saturday night with the Bombers and the TQ Midgets. Great show, great fun. Take the family out there, have some hot dogs. But I'm not going to cover it.
Yeah.
I might go and enjoy it,
yeah.
which I do. You know, I like to go out to Merrittville and Speedway. It's a dirt track over by Thorold here. And they have the Southern Ontario Sprints, and sometimes they have a Oswego Speedway. Mm-hmm. Have you guys ever been out there?
Mm-hmm. I've been to the dirt track with my parents. A couple of the small ones. There's one up near Wasaga Beach in Collingwood
right.
Speedway.
Right.
Like I've been there
right.
as a kid. We used to go with,
well,
my,
you gotta
with my family.
Go to Oswego Speedway and see the World of Outlaws. And the World of Outlaws are sprint cars. It's the Indy 500. It's the United States Grand Prix of sprint cars. You should see these guys. And I mean, they got 410 big block motors with all the power in the world. It's only a third of a mile dirt oval, which
it's
means you're out of
loud.
Control most of the time. Oh yeah, you know, you go there and you're, you know, you've got to keep your mouth shut because otherwise it's full of sand.
Yeah.
You know? And they get going and you almost feel like you're in the middle of a hurricane. Yeah. But the fact of the matter is, these guys are controlling these cars and they're racing, and it's just phenomenal to watch some of these guys. Now I'll go and cover that, but I could easily go and just sit there and enjoy it too.
I think a lot of people don't know how many small tracks there are around Southern Ontario.
Well, you know, again, I think that trying to get some of this stuff covered is not going to happen.
That's an uphill battle.
It's just not going to happen, yeah. and it doesn't matter. They're out there having fun again. You know, it's a good place to go have some hot dogs. Drink a couple of beers, enjoy the races, but it's not the cream of the cream. You know, in order to be, like, I mean, we'll go back to the hockey analogy for a minute, right? Some of the best hockey in this province is junior hockey. It is. Mm-hmm. It's some of the best hockey in this province is junior hockey. And I live in Mississauga, and two or three times a year I'll go over and watch what are now called the Steelheads. They start when I first moved to Mississauga 100 years ago. We have the Ice Dogs.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
And they got transferred to... okay, so where are we? Are we talking again? Are we...
Okay. To bring it back to Formula One right now, is there something... We know about the regulation changes.
Right.
A lot of people are excited about them because the cars are going to look different. They're going to look fast without moving, right? Like that. That's
oh, well, wait a second. Toto Wolff said in every year, Mercedes holds a special breakfast just for Canadian media. And Toto Wolff comes in, and they bring Robert Wickens over. He's in the DTM.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of Canadian
and happy.
Guys.
He's that, really happy.
He's
there.
Canadian,
oh, well, you know, well, yeah, he's getting paid.
Yeah.
You know? well, you know what? It's too bad. His career took a bit of a right turn. He had a chance to... He should be in Formula One.
Yeah, he was talking about
for a while there.
Yeah, he remember, he won the Formula 2 championship the one year, he won the Formula Renault F3.5.
Yeah.
And I mean, he won it, and the guy who was second went to Formula One. Now, how does that happen?
Money.
Right? Money. Well, there you go. And so that's, you know, that's why I call motor racing dysfunctional racing, you know. I think that Formula One has gotten a little off track the last couple of years because they allowed themselves to be enveloped in the whole environmental movement. Don't misunderstand when I say that. We all want to conserve stuff, right? You know, packaging is a classic example. I'm delighted. This is really off the track, by the way.
Yeah, go for it.
But you know, you go to Loblaws and you buy a package of 8 burgers that used to say sirloin or prime rib on them, and they come in a big box, right? And you take them out of the box, which was entirely too big. Now they've got them kind of shrink wrapped, right?
Yeah.
So you still get the same product, but you're not using up all that space and all that material, right? So we all want to conserve. We all want to, and this comes down to economics too, why should I be spending a lot of money on fuel for this car if in fact I don't have to spend as much money on, fuel or a power source over here. So I'm not against electric cars or hybrids or anything like that. But you know something? That's not Formula One. Formula One has always been the Mount Everest of motorsport. And it is supposed to be exciting. It's supposed to be loud. It's supposed to be thrilling. The ground is supposed to shake when these cars go by. And the last 3 or 4 years, they haven't.
No.
And they're running these hybrids, half electric. They sound like some sewing machines up there. You stand, I go down every year and stand for the first practice at the first turn at Montreal at Circuit Gilles Villeneuve. You can't even hear the car coming until it's there. Then it makes a noise, but it's a strange noise. It's not a noise that says, power.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm looking for in Formula.
There's not a lot of testosterone in that.
No, this is what I want in Formula One.
Yeah, especially the ERS noise when they're harvesting in the brake.
It
sounds horrible.
Yeah.
Please. So I really think the bigger tires, the loosening of the engine rules.
Yeah.
Toto Wolff says that they will go 5 seconds a lap faster this year than they were last year.
Yeah.
And I say, bring it on, because that's what I want to see. And you know, the faster the car goes, the better the driver has to be. Because, you know, with the ground effects and the driver's aids, you know, it's not, okay, don't take me literally here. You and I can't get into these cars and race them like those guys can.
No.
But you know what? Those cars are a hell of a lot easier to race now than 10 years ago. 20 years ago. I mean, you know, Jacques was saying yesterday that every time they make a change, to improve the product. They wind up wrecking it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he said, just go back to the beginning. And what he meant was, listen, you're in the car. You got a gear shift. You know, I mean, you read the stories of races in the old days. You guys have to read the stories. I was there. Right? And all of a sudden, there'd be two cars going into, say, the hairpin.
Yeah.
And then only one car's come. Why is that? Because a guy missed a shift. Mm-hmm. You know, something happened. Yeah. He screwed up. And the other guy didn't. And away he went. Now they got engine management system. Oh, these guys don't even have to shift anymore. They don't even have to do that.
Well, yeah, you just have to pull on the steering wheel to get the clutch pressed down.
You, that's right. You just have to put your foot on the floor and hold on and go. Now, yes, you still have the competition mano-a-mano, but there are not the variables that can change the outcome of a race now like there used to be. And I think he's absolutely right. I think that you've got to reintroduce, not artificially, because that's why they're doing it. Artificially.
Yeah.
Just take it back to what car racing was, and people will be much happier.
Oh,
the drivers will be much happier. The spectators will be much happier.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, so I'm hoping that this year we'll start to bring back a little more of that.
Well,
you know,
you kind of touched on something that I find, like, I'm super interested in this. I've kind of been, like, focusing a lot, and it does seem like Formula One in recent years has been going through a bit of an identity crisis. It's like they know that Formula One is supposed to be the pinnacle of motorsport,
right?
But they don't know what that means. Like, does it have to be open cockpit? Does it have to be this? Does it? What kind of engines should it have? Part of what I think that worked back in the day,
right?
Back in the golden years of
Formula
One, is that you also had the talent, but the talent came from everywhere. Now there's a lot of, it's narrowing down the path to F1. You have to go to cars, you have to some sort of formula, whereas back in the day you could come
Make up a story on Sunday.
Or you came from rallying, or you came from sports cars, and there's not a lot of that happens. I feel like maybe we're missing out on some perfectly good talent out there.
Well, we are. And that's now, however, the accepted road. And it's all of car racing. It's not just Formula One. All of it is like that. If you want to go to Indy cars now, you have to go through what they call the road to Indy.
Mm-hmm.
You have to go through Star Mazda series. Then you got to go Indy Lights. Mm-hmm. And then you go from there to Indy cars. Ask Mario Andretti if that's the way he got to IndyCar. Ask Mario Andretti if that's the way he got to Formula One. No. And it's the same thing. There's not that switching back and forth that it used to be. I mean, he's nearly dead now, but A.J. Foyt, for example, he was a great IndyCar driver, and he was a great NASCAR driver. He could, you know, Mario Andretti is going to be the Grand Marshal next weekend at Daytona, because in 1967, he won the Daytona 500, right? You could go back and forth.
Yeah.
And now they can't, because of stupid rules and regulations, accepted routes. And also, I think that there's something else to it here too. And it comes down to money, and it comes down to society. When you were talking about Formula One's identity crisis, you're absolutely right. But that was because the engine manufacturers kind of got caught up in the way society is going. And there's nothing wrong with the way society is going, but it's not racing. Mm. And you've got to be able to separate the two. And I think they realize that, and that's why they're coming back this way a little bit. But, and everything in life, you can get into a rut.
Yeah.
Pardon me. You can get into a rut. And I think car racing has been in a rut recently. And, you know, we talk about the artificial ways. I know that this is about Formula One. But if you read about what NASCAR is doing, NASCAR has now decided they're going to split their races up into three segments.
Oh, my God.
And one segment of a 200-lap race, the first segment is going to be 30 laps. And the winner of that 30 laps is going to get points. And, you know, I don't think they're going to stop the race and have a ceremony, but, you know, you never know. And then they're going to have it for, you know, and I mean, I'm thinking to myself, this is totally nuts.
The chase at the end of the season too, however that works, the 8,000 points and like, oh, it's what is going on?
Absolutely crazy. And the average person, they say, oh, where have the fans gone? The fans don't understand this.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The fans don't understand. I mean, this nonsense would kill them. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people are saying this is a make or break year for motor racing, period.
Wow.
You know, well, there's fewer and fewer fans going. I mean, you know, even though I disagree, sports editors aren't stupid. They might have made the correct decision here that it's not worth it to pay somebody to be a beat writer. Mm-hmm. Again, you know, but is there the interest out there? Maybe there's just not the interest. Maybe there's just not.
I think they could have waited one more year.
Well, maybe, maybe. You never know. You know, I mean, in Dean's case, he really wanted to retire. It's not a man. I mean, he'd like to come back and cover the odd race, but, you know, I don't think that he wanted to do what he was doing anymore. And Jeff was just a victim of circumstance, and he's ready to go. He was here. He was here yesterday.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it's, but, you know, the reason NASCAR's done what it's done is because their ratings are down on television, people aren't, and that's because they have just gimmicked it up so much that people don't understand and they don't want to understand. They want to watch, what's a car race? You start the race and, okay, 30 laps later in sprint cars, 50 laps later in super modifieds, 100 laps later in stock cars or whatever, then a guy gets, or a woman gets a checkered flag. That's what people want to see.
Right.
If absolutely. They get a couple of wrecks in the meantime, as long as nobody's hurt, you know, it adds to the excitement. But that's what racing is. It's not all this gimmicky stuff that's going on.
And people can see through that. I feel like the fans, like, no,
well, they're turning away from it.
Yeah, because you can see right through it, and if it's too artificial, if it takes away from the sport, like you don't feel as rewarded as a fan from sitting there and spending your time watching it. You
absolutely.
Can do something else.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I guess we can maybe like close soon by saying, if you had to change something in F1, I know that's the what would you change? How to bring that back, the excitement back?
I'd do what Jacques Villeneuve said. I'd take away the driver aids, and I would make it so that maybe not the gear shift there. We'll put them on the back of the wheel. We don't want to be completely dumb about this. But I would take car racing back to where the driver is. You know, look, the car is always going to be the dominant factor in car racing. Mm-hmm. But right now, if you talk to somebody who is racing in the big leagues now, whether it's Sebastian Vettel or James Hinchcliffe, they essentially will say to you, the car is 80% and the driver is 20. I kind of like that to go back to 50-50 or 60-40 or something like that, where the driver, certainly. I mean, it's like a horse race. Some horses can run faster than others. And naturally, the best jockeys seem to get the best horses.
Right.
And you know, if you're a candidate for the glue factory, you can put the world's greatest jockey on that horse, and that horse is not going to run any faster. But I think in car racing, unless it's a team that's a dead loss, they are reasonably equal. And I think that it would be better for the sport if, you know, I'm not sure it could ever be 50-50. But the driver's got to be at least 40% of the equation, and the way to make that is to dial the clock back and let the drivers drive the car and make the decision of where they're going to brake and make the decision of where they're going to shift their gears and make the decision to do whatever.
That's gonna
make the show better, the spectacle better, and the racing more interesting.
Nice. Great.
Okay.
Yeah, cool. Thank you so much.
Thanks for your time.
I'm sorry that we had to kind of dial it back a little bit because this is all temporary stuff, right?
Yeah, it's like a...
And the general manager's in there with a couple of cabinet ministers, and I'm standing up there going, yeah.
Oh,
Great talk, though.
Yeah, great to meet you.
Yeah.
Listen, thanks so much. I'm delighted.